Yeah. Displayed in your birth, and the opportunity to celebrate that and delight in that and just share in this time together. Lord, we just pray for your Holy Spirit to fill this place and touch our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, Merry Christmas, everybody. You may be seated and welcome. Thank you all for being here. You may be seated unless you're, let's say, 12 years or younger. And then if you would, if you're feeling brave, you can come up to the front here. We actually have a little present under the tree you can get. You want to hand those out? Thank you. And bring your key in. Don't bring those out. And all you 12 years and younger can sit. And you're kind of up in here. You're so great. Thank you. So, being Christmas Eve and all, if you're 12, we'll let you come up too. Mariah, only if you want.
She was so like,
right, you're 12?
For like 3 days.
4 more days.
Really? All right. I mean, I guess if there are people older than 12 who really want to come up, you're welcome to. Come on down. So, and you can stay up here because tonight for Christmas Eve, we're going to really try to make this as interactive with the kids as possible. So as soon as you get your bags, go ahead and sit down. And you can kind of fill in up here, because I need your help. And so tonight, instead of me reading the whole Christmas story and kind of going through it, I think many of these young people have heard the Christmas story a time or two, so I thought maybe you could help me. You guys, you okay with that? You excited for that? Did anybody hear me? All right, so as we think about the Christmas story, how many of you have heard the Christmas story? Raise your hand. All right, so where does the Christmas story begin? Who's usually the first people we hear about in the Christmas story? Real loud and clear.
Mary and Joseph.
Mary and Joseph are a big part of the Christmas story.
And Jesus.
And Jesus. Can you think Adam and Eve? This guy up here in the pajama pants. I'm just kidding. All right.
Gabriel.
Who's that?
Gabriel.
All right, but let's think way back in the beginning of Luke. There's some people even before Mary and Joseph, and not the genealogies, we won't go into that. But do you remember maybe Jesus' cousin? Anybody know that part of the story? What were his parents' names? Somebody, I guess 12 or older can help them out. Zechariah and Elizabeth. And who did they, whose baby was theirs?
John
the Baptist. All right, so we start the Christmas story with Elizabeth, and she has a baby, right? Zechariah's in the temple, and then comes back, and his wife is pregnant, and they have John the Baptist, right? And then who visits Mary? This interactive thing's hard. They're all looking at their bags. So who visits Mary? The angel? I really envision this going a lot smoother. Can you just stand up and share the Christmas story? So, the bags were like a beautiful distraction right now. So we have Mary being visited by Gabriel. And what does he tell her? She's going to have a baby.
Put all the dates back.
And you're going to name him Jesus, right? And then who visits Joseph? Gabriel, again, this guy's busy, right? So he tells Joseph, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, right? And over the past few weeks, we've looked at Joseph, we've looked at Mary, we've looked at Simeon and Anna, we've looked at the shepherds and kind of heard these parts of the story, right? This incredible, beautiful story that many of us are familiar with, and you're not. If you're not, I encourage you, go read Matthew and Luke tonight, the first couple chapters. This beautiful, beautiful story of God's love for humanity. His love so much that God steps into humanity as a baby, as Jesus, right? And what happens when they go to Bethlehem? They go because of a census, those bags. Kimber, you did a great job with those bags. Because they're quiet, I can't hear it, but they're all completely occupied, which is great. So, then Jesus is born. And as we go through tonight, I need some more help because we're going to sing a couple more songs here in a second. And then we're going to end my sermon tonight that's got some interactive stuff with you guys as well. So you guys, you good with that? Excellent. Seamus is ready. All right. So if you guys would lead us in a few more songs. So you guys, now your next big part is to help with the singing. To stand up and help with the singing. You ready? Here we go.
Angels, we have heard our cry, sweetly sing.
And tonight we're going to look at the Christmas story from a little different part. But first, I want to share a little story that happened to me just the other day, a memory, as I was sitting on my fireplace, right? It's early in the morning, it's cold, I just started the fire, so it hasn't gotten too hot yet, and you just kind of lean against it and get that heat, right? Anybody ever do that? No? Nobody else, like, you lean against the steel just to feel the heat? All right, well, it brought back a memory for me. And I wonder if any of you guys can identify with this, because it's been just a little cold lately, hasn't it? Even by Leadville standards. I mean, today wasn't bad, but the last couple of weeks has been fairly chilly. So if you're from out of town and you're thinking, it's been cold, right? But I was reminded, and when I grew up in Detroit, and we had an old house. And can anybody guess what was in every room of the house, even the bathrooms?
How about the fireplace?
Not a fireplace, but close. That would be cool though, a fireplace in the bathroom. Just thinking. A what? A handle. Okay, there were door handles. A candle. We should have candles in the bathrooms, but no, not candles either. One more. Somebody else has yelled it out. Radiant. Did you say radiant?
What?
Yes. Well, Norm leaned into me while we were singing and said, I'm the oldest looking 12-year-old up here. I told him he fit right in. But in every room in our old house in Detroit, there was a radiator. So a radiator, do you guys know what a radiator is? It's this giant chunk of cast iron, right? Cast iron, and it's hollow, and it's got all these tubes through it, and it's super heavy and super old, and some houses still have similar things, like pipes in the floors or baseboards. But radiators, when the heat was on, would heat up nicely. And I can remember, I can't remember if it was my great-grandma or this older woman. We had great-grandma. Whenever she would visit, she never moved her bottom side off of the radiator. Like, she just sat on it. And I remember, as I leaned against the fireplace the other morning, it brought back that memory of spending most of my childhood in the winter in Detroit sitting on a radiator. Like, we just couldn't move from it because radiators were so nice. Now, during the last few weeks when it's been cold, did any of you tend to hover around a heat place in your house?
No.
Where was it? Where do you go, Gracie? You just did it. You're not sure where? Somewhere. Near a fireplace.
My heater in my bedroom.
Your heater in your bedroom. What does that look like? I mean, is it like a vent in the wall or a floor? All right, and does like hot air come through that vent?
Yeah.
Nice.
And I have a heater.
You have a heater too?
I have
you
a fireplace.
You and your brother are so lucky. And a fireplace. So you want to stay near that heat, right?
I have a bed.
You have a bed? Do you just stay in bed for the last 2 weeks, 3 weeks? All right. You learn a lot in an interactive service like this. Right? But when it's hot, I mean, how many of you as well? Abel, you haven't moved from that fireplace in a couple weeks, my friend. I know, and whenever Benita comes in there, like everybody else is like, it's too hot. Benita and Abel, right by the fire. But right when it's staying near that source of heat, whether that's your radiator or the vent, wherever that comes, I think all of us can identify with that a little bit. All right, well, we're going to look at John's gospel tonight. So John wrote one of the Gospels. He was one of Jesus' followers. He was very close to Jesus. And if you want to follow along, you can read in John chapter 1. So we usually look at Matthew or Luke for the Christmas stories. We go back to Isaiah and look at some of the prophecies, Micah, other places. But John chapter 1 isn't always the first place we go. But that's where we're going to go tonight and look at a couple different things. So in John chapter 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. So what was made without the Word?
Nothing.
Ha, way to go, Johnny. Nice work. All right. Last time I do that. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John, right? And his parents were? Nicely done. I'd give you a fist bump, but I won't. All right. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light. What's the true light, Asher? The true light. I can do that because that's my kid. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. All right. You like that, Shanice? So as we're going to look at a few different themes from this passage. But as we begin that, I have a question first. We've got all the kids up here. Parents, can you remember some of the first sounds, noises, phrases, babblings your children made? What did it sound? What were some of the first things that stand out to you?
Dada.
Dada. All the guys, like my kids said dada first. What were some of the noises, sounds? Jack's first word was what? What's that? Curious from the start. What's that? What were some other first sounds, noises, words?
Mama.
Mama. Mama.
Mama.
Mama. Mama.
Mama. Mama. Dad. Dad. They didn't come till I was like 10.
Oh, icy? Man, that's impressive. Right? Anybody else got something clever? Something not clever. Your kids don't have to be clever. Just something you remember.
No.
No. No. Was that Adam or Luke?
All of us.
No.
Booty.
Booty.
No,
it's
birdie.
Oh, birdie. Birdie. Not her dog. All right. And can any of you tell me what you think the first sound that came out of your mouth was when you were born? Everybody else, go! Beautiful. Now, thinking about that, looking at where we started, do you guys remember what we read at the very start here? In the beginning was the
Word.
And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Right? When we think about that first line, in the beginning was the Word, the spoken, when time began, when God spoke and started to create, started to materialize things out of nothing. God was already there before any substances, anything existed other than God himself. God spoke, and through the Word, how much of that was created?
Everything.
Everything. Good job. All things. Nothing was created without God speaking it forth. And if you remember, what's the first book of the Bible?
Genesis.
Chapter 1. These guys are on it. Good job, parents. Genesis chapter 1, beginning in verse 3, God says over and over something, or the Bible tells us something over and over. It says, God said, let there be light, let there be an expanse, let there be a separation and dry ground appearing, let there be, you know, plants, let there be animals, let there, God said, through his spoken word, God the Father, his spoken word, right? And then at the end of this, John 1:14, the word, that spoken word of God, what happened to it that we celebrate at Christmas? The word became flesh. It made his dwelling among us. Think for just a minute. When we celebrate Christmas, so we get wrapped up in the stories, we get wrapped up in little baby Jesus, and we love it. But when you think about the glory and the beauty and the power and the majesty of what we're celebrating, it's not just about a baby being born. It's about God's word taking on flesh and stepping into humanity. When you think about the very word of God that has always been, and through whom everything that is was made, right? The very word of God, through whom everything that exists was spoken into being through, taking on flesh, and the first things that come out of its mouth are? Just think about that for a minute. Great job. Let that settle in. The humility of God, the love of God, the compassion of God, who in his absolute wisdom and power and glory steps into humanity. The Word became flesh. That is beautiful. And do you know why the Word stepped into humanity? Why Jesus came?
To save us.
To save us from our sins. I hear you talking, but you turned away. But yes, the Word stepped in. The Word became flesh. And just think about this as you go home tonight. The eternal Word of God, what Father, Son, and Spirit forever dwelling in perfect unity. The Word of God, this active agent, God's creative force in creating the world through whom he created everything, stepped into humanity. The Word of God became a babbling baby. I just love that idea. Right? The Word of God said, Mama. Probably not exactly like that, but maybe he said birdie or whatever. You know, the Word of God had a first word. Isn't that beautiful? Like, I don't know about you, but that's hard for me to get my mind around. Like, that takes a lot of faith and a lot of trust, but that's the love of God extended to us. In Philippians chapter 2, this is one of the earliest hymns of the church, earliest writings of the church. This didn't evolve or develop over time, over many years. This is what the church believed from the very start and taught clearly. Paul says this, in your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, so he is God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. So what likeness was Jesus made in?
Human likeness.
And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Right? When we think about the Word becoming flesh, God took on flesh so that he could live and die and rise from the dead, so that, as you said before, we might be saved, we might be freed from sin and have life in him. The Word of God became a babbling baby. I love it. All right. There's another word that stands out from John chapter 1. That we're going to look at a little bit here. So it says, in him, in verse 4, was life. In him was life. The Word of God became flesh. In him was life. Now, how many of you feel like you have life right now? Are you alive?
Yeah.
You're going to check your pulse. We'll have Hannah come down and do some checking on, right? You're exhausted, but you still have life, right? You're always exhausted. Jesus talks about in him is life. Right? And Jesus says often, talked about life quite a bit in his teachings. John chapter 14, verse 6. I am the way, the truth, and the what?
Life.
No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus made it clear. If you want to live, you want to find life, it is through me, it's through him that we truly live. Right? In John 10, verse 10, Jesus says, I have come so that you might have life and have it to the full. Right? I want to read one more verse, again from John in one of his letters, and I think it doesn't get clearer than this. John says in 1 John chapter 5, verse 11, and this is the testimony, God has given us eternal life. So that means life to the full, life forever, life complete as it was meant to be, eternal life. And this life is in his Son. And who's the Son of God?
Jesus!
Oh, you guys are so good. Never had so much feedback from a message. I'm going to do this every Sunday. No. Children's ministry is canceled. We're keeping them in here. Just kidding.
Why don't we get that much feedback on some account?
Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. Right? And you might be thinking, well, I know a lot of people who are alive, right? But here's where that register, you guys thought I was just talking about cold days and wanted to talk about my heating register, radiators, right? But this is it. A radiator in a room is very little good, or like the vent Liam in your bedroom, right? The steel metal tin vent. Those things aren't all that useful unless they're hooked to something, right?
Right.
What are they hooked to?
Electricity.
Well, not a radiator so much, but something. A furnace, right? A heat source, a source that Jesus talked about, a vine and branches, and the branches being connected to the vine, right? Talking about heat and being connected to the source. Life comes when we're connected to the source of life, to the one who came to give life, true life, life with meaning, life with purpose, life with direction, life the way it was meant to be, not just cold, kind of making it through, taking up space in a room. No offense, anybody. But life, the way we were created to live it, full and complete, is when we're connected to the one who gives life. And who gives life?
Jesus!
Oh, you guys are on. You're preaching my next sermon. Jesus came so that we might have life in him. Have life that's guided and purposeful and meaningful, and then we'll have life to the full forever with him. All right, so the last thing I want to look at, Johnny or Mariah, Tinley, can you grab, what's behind that plant there? What is it? Can you stand up and hold that up so everybody can see it? What is that thing? Who knows what that is? Kids, anybody know what that is? A headlamp. Is that what? Headlamp. All right, can you figure out how to turn that thing on? Oh, nice. So, all right, so that way we can turn it off again. So, great job. Oh, it's a little tricky. You want me to get it?
Yeah.
There you go. So, I brought my headlamp as an example. You can sit that down now. I have had the privilege of helping out with search and rescue for a number of years and have been less helpful over the last couple of years, but have done a lot of calls. Anybody know what search and rescue is?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can call and then up a mountain and then you find dead guys.
Occasionally things like that happen. But search and rescue can go and help people who are lost, help situations, save people and help out. And there's a lot of amazing people who help with that. Sorry, if you were in the back and didn't hear that, he said you go up the mountain at night and get dead people. So that's not typically the case, just sometimes. But a lot of the calls we get, so get this, I can't, you know, tell too many details, but a lot of the calls we get come in right after it's dark, and they're usually people, no offense, Texans, but a lot of them are from Texas or other sunnier states. People who come to Colorado and decide they want to hike Mount Massive or Mount Albert. So they leave at 10 o'clock in the morning or 11 o'clock in the morning after a nice snack and a visit to the coffee shop. And they go out and they hike up. And the problem with hiking a 14er is you don't want to stop till you get to the top, even if you know you should turn back. So a lot of people get going and going and they don't want to turn back. And they get to the top right about sundown, and they start coming down the mountain, and then they start running out of water and food, water, food, and energy. And then by the time they hit tree line, this happens so very often, and I'm sure it won't happen to any of us in this room, but just so you know, when you have guests coming to town, this happens a lot. They hit right near tree line, and usually it's just getting really dark, and they're not necessarily lost, they just can't see very well. Right? So they get out their phone, hopefully they have the reception, they call in and they say, we need help, we're lost. And what often happens, and I hate to say this and I give this away, but we call them sad pandas. Because that's kind of what it feels like. You get the call and a team gets mobilized, we hike up, we get to the people, and they're wonderful people. No fault, I mean, it can happen to anybody. All of us can make mistakes in the woods or find ourselves in situations where we need help. So not making fun of people, but they need help. And we get there, you give them a little food, a little water, some electrolytes, and then guess what happens? You turn your headlamp on, and you show the trail, and they don't need to be carried out, they don't need a helicopter. Sometimes, we're taking people out of helicopters and horses and everything else, litters, all those things. But usually, 9 times out of 10, if they can see the trail because of something as simple as a light, then they can keep going. A lot of times in life, people find themselves feeling pretty lost, and it can be pretty scary, and you can not quite sense where you're supposed to go, and you just feel like you're going in circles. Jesus said, or John said, Holy Spirit speaking through John, in him was life, and that was the light of all mankind. In him, the Word becoming flesh, becoming a babbling baby, through whom we have life. If we look to him, he is the light to all mankind. I love, as Luke tells the story of the gospel, of the Christmas story, Mary and Joseph bring baby Jesus into the temple to dedicate him, and a guy by the name of Simeon, who the Holy Spirit told him he would live until he saw the Messiah, and the Holy Spirit told him, go, the Messiah is there, went and took the baby and said, Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation in this little baby, right, wrapped in cloths. My eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Jesus is the light. He's the light of the world. He's the light of revelation to the Gentiles, to all of us. If we want to find life, if we want to know why we're here, where we're going, what God has for us today, if we want to live life to the full, it's looking to the light, looking to the Son of God who came to show us the way to the Father. Isn't that pretty incredible? So whenever you're feeling lost, whenever you're feeling afraid, even it doesn't just happen to kids, teenagers, adults, all of us find ourselves at points in life where we just feel lost. And that can be, I just need to look to Jesus for life, for salvation, or I need to look to Jesus for guidance. I need to look to Jesus for the next step, for hope, for tomorrow, for the peace I need today. Jesus is the one who gives life, and he reveals the Father to us. So this Christmas, as you guys go home tonight, and all of us, we want to celebrate, we want to remember the wise men and the shepherds, we want to remember all these things, but I pray you remember it even deeper. Not just as cute and wonderful stories which should be shared and need to be shared, but what these stories represent is the love of God, the Word of God become flesh, to give us life and to reveal the Father to us, to illuminate our path, to reveal God to us. All right? Let's pray. God, we thank you so much, Jesus, that you are the light of the world. God, as the star led the wise men to the manger, to Jesus 2,000 years ago, God, I pray that your light, Jesus, would lead us into a deeper relationship forever with God. Lord, we thank you that you give life. We thank you that you are the Word made flesh. We praise you for this time tonight to celebrate these amazing truths together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, as we celebrate Jesus as the light of the world, I would invite you all to stand. And kids, if you want to go back to your parents now, they might want to have you next to them for this part. We're going to sing Silent Night. We're going to light the candles. And I'll have Maria help me here. But as we light the Christ candle, we are reminded, no matter how far, in John chapter 1, verse 5, it says, the darkness cannot overcome the light. The darkness cannot overcome the light. No matter how dark it is or feels, it will not overcome the light. So we'll bring the candles to you. And I ask the one who holds the light, please hold it steady, and then people whose candles are not lit, tip your candle into the light, and then you can light it so wax doesn't go everywhere. It would be wonderful. And Aaron, if you want to kill the light, and I'll just light the end one on the row, and you can pass it on down. Sharing the light. Thank you.
Thank you.
God.
Terrible.